warm welcome to one and all. So, doctor, this is a request by the citizen, exclusively one set of apartments who came forward because they were quite keen to know about the fibrillator device. How was it used? And, you know, just because the apartment is working on safety, they do have the emergency medical room that is set up. Despite that, they wanted to, you know, have the defibrillator also with them just to understand, and probably a training also is required. So they wanted the session on ground, but, you know, we had a little bit of limited in terms of the audience plus the infrastructure. That's how we requested that we would have you on board on a virtual session. And then probably, you know, the demonstration can be done going to their premises. So audience, welcome all. So we have Professor and Dr. Ranjan Shetty, who is the HOD and consultant of Manipal Hospital's Old Airport Road. So doctor is expert in left atrial appendage, transaortic valve implantation, that is TAVI, complex coronary interventions, and the septal defect closures, just to name a few. But I can just go on and on. So doctor has a lot of credibility, but just limiting my session here. Also, doctor is a member of American College of Cardiology, European Society of Cardiology plus India. So over to you, doctor. So the whole session is planned in such a way that we have come prepared with set of questions. So I will asking you the question and then probably you can elaborate. Then we will you know, open the floor for discussion, followed by the demonstration of fibrillator. Yeah. So can we begin with our questions today?
Sure, Bob. Sure.
Okay. So first of all, we want to understand what is emergency and what are the conditions that fall under cardiac emergency, doctor?
Yes. First of all, you know, warm welcome to all of you and thank you for joining on a Sunday. This shows your interest in this field and, you know, Bhavana has been driving a program called Guardians of Heart for last 2 years and we are very happy that you understand the need for defibrillator. And you are here to train with us. Now, let me elaborate on cardiac emergencies. You know, heart attack itself is the biggest emergency. That's what we keep telling people. There's nothing called minor heart attack. All heart attacks are important. So anybody with a chest pain, you should not neglect it. Like you have a chest pain, which is on left side or central. It comes to your hand, comes to your neck. Or if there is a sweating, please don't neglect it. It could be gastric, as you are thinking right now. Or as you think when you have chest pain, but it's still worth a shot to go to nearest medical center, get an ECG done, because only 4% of heart attacks are missed in ECG. So when there is a suspicion of heart attack, my advice to all of you is do not try first aid. Do not try to give aspirin or anything you want to give. Probably it is wasting your time. More important is to reach medical care, because the person is conscious. He's talking to you and he's complaining of a symptom. It's a very crucial time which should not be wasted. Now the second one, which I think where we come in and where this training comes in, is heart arrest, you know, cardiac arrest. So people, you know, interchange these terms. They think attack and arrest is same. They are not same. Attack is when there is no blood flow to the heart. Heart is crying for blood and you have symptoms. And you need to rush into medical. Arrest is where you're unconscious. You know, the person who probably either with chest pain or without chest pain is directly now unconscious. This is where we want you to act, you know, not delay, but act, because that was the whole premise of Guardians of Heart Initiative. So the first step there is to assess. And the second step there is to call for help. The third step there is to start CPR. You know, that's what we are trying to do. So arrest patient does not have any time. He's unconscious, he or she is just falling, is down. And your window period is just 2 to 3 minutes. It should be the bystander who does all these things. So that's where we want you to act. And that's where we want you to make sure, you don't waste time. Now, what should you do at that time? First, assess for signs of life. That means look for breathing. If the person is breathing, not gasping, breathing, you know, simple, smooth breathing. Usually heart is also working at that time. You don't have to worry. It could be a syncope if that occurs. Look for any signs of, that's a different disease altogether. But a person still maybe slightly cold is now just gasping for breath or no breath. You need to start CPR. So by doing that, you could save a lot of life because, properly initiated CPR, the survival, overall outcome is 40% people survive. And if no CPR is given to cardiac arrest, only 7% survive. That means you could make a 30 to 33% difference in your near and dear ones, So that is something we should start. And we have had extensive video, I'm sure Bhavana will share with you those videos of CPR and how to do it. The next step of CPR is defibrillator, because heart stop shocking helps. And I'm extremely happy that this community has taken up that initiative to go to the next step. So that means there are three steps: management of heart attack, management of cardiac arrest, and shocking the cardiac arrest. So I'm sure Bhavana also will be extremely excited, because this is what we wanted every community to do. And thank you for coming forward to do this. Yeah.
So before we go extensive, the difference between heart attack and cardiac arrest. So, we've just prepared a basic question. So for people to understand, doctor. So first of all, people experience something called chest pain for the first time. So where exactly the pain is felt, and how do they know that this is a cardiac pain, not any other pain?
Yes. So the pain, what cardiac patient, perceives is very atypical. It's not one point. It's always diffuse. People don't know where is it coming from, because heart is a deeper organ. So you don't typically, pinpoint it. If you can pinpoint it, if it is pricking type, it's unlikely to be heart. If it is heaviness, so-called bharipan in Hindi, or, chap in Bengali, that as if somebody is compressing on your chest, it need not be left side, it can be central. Typically, it is above umbilicus and it can go up to the jaw. So any of these reasons are poorly localized pain, which is more like heaviness, is supposed to be a cardiac pain. Now, the same pain could occur when people walk, and when they rest, it could disappear. This is stable angina. When they walk, they get this pain. It comes to the hand sometimes, goes to the neck sometimes, goes to the stomach sometimes, but above umbilicus. It's like a heaviness, but as you take rest, it decreases. That's one kind of pain. The same pain, now more intensity, occurring at rest is heart attack. The same pain, but more intensity, usually associated with sweating. Now, the differential is gastric. Because you have not eaten, or people tend to explain their symptoms also and they attribute it to gastric. Now, it could be gastric. For all you know, the pain which you are feeling may not be very classical, and it could, we could go here and there. That's where the importance of reaching out and getting an ECG comes in play. So ECG done properly, the chance of you missing a heart attack is only 4%.
Yes, doctor. So over that, I had another question. So now, how do you differentiate between a gastritis, a heartburn, and a chest pain? See, because you are a doctor, you can understand. But for a layman, all the three might appear the same. But how is that they tend to understand and come to a conclusion, doctor?
Okay. So I will answer in two ways, Bhavana. I'll definitely tell how to distinguish. But more important is the key point is, please don't neglect it. You might think it is gastric. You might think it is heart attack. But please don't neglect it. Reach out for medical help. Do not try a first aid. That's the first point. Second, I'll still tell you how to distinguish. Typically, the gastric pain is more abdominal, means little lower down. And if you press it, you could feel some pain. And typically, it is associated with burps, that burping kind. Whereas heart pain is more diffuse, it's more up, can come to hand and can come to neck. But even for medical expert, it may be difficult to distinguish both. And people like diabetic, elderly, female may not have classical symptom at all. They might just have breathlessness. So keeping all this in mind, if you have risk factors, better to, reach out. Don't try your own distinguish. Don't try to drink and, but go to a medical center. But yes, once you go there, people might tell, no, it's not heart attack. Take a, or give a pan. Be very happy and come back. Because your chance of it being heart attack is only 10%. with all chest pain. Two, three things I would say, do not neglect these red signs. One of them is sweating. The pain is associated with sweating. Pain lasting for 5 to 10 minutes. Any anxiety associated with pain, because heart is an organ which, it's a visceral organ. So usually pain with heart is associated with some autonomic activation, which could be sweating, which could be, feeling of anxiety. They know. Sometimes the patient knows that this is not what they've gone through before at all. This is different from what they felt. And the bystander may not understand it, but the patient understands. So anytime the patient feels, no, this is not normal, I'm not fine, please reach out again. As of this one, it may be a futile, journey at middle of the night, because heart attacks are also, but believe me, it's worth it. Because 1/3 of the heart attack patients do not reach hospital. 1/3, it's a big number. We do a lot of things for heart attack. We open up the cath lab, do angioplasty, but then we lose 1/3 because they have not even reached the hospital. So don't do that. And I know it's very difficult for people to understand, but this one message may be more important than learning CPR itself. Yeah.
Sure, doctor. Why is it called heartburn? That means to say there's the chest burn, or what is heartburn?
Yeah. This is a very good question, Bhavna. Actually, heartburn is not a heart attack. Heartburn is actually gastric. So whenever people use heartburn, it is a gastric which produces esophageal inflammation. So if heartburn is used, it's not a cardiac pain. But, that means you can understand when people who coined the term did not distinguish between two. People who coined. So it's very, very difficult even for a doctor. So don't try it. Please, reach hospital.
Sure, doctor. I think the recent demise of Siddharth Shukla indeed pushed all of us into peril, because he was into fitness and he did follow the diet regime, but it was so unfortunate. Not only him, there are many, celebrities, including, following the fitness regime, are prone to heart attacks. So why is this? So that means to say fitness really does not contribute, or exercise really does not contribute to maintain heart, or how would you want to define this, doctor?
Yeah. Now, I think again, a very interesting question. So, very important true to understand the timing of heart attacks and what produces heart attack. So if we can start a little bit from before, see, heart attack means blockage in the arteries in the heart. So heart arteries, the cholesterol, in a simple words, gets modified and it gets built and it produces some blockage. Now, blockage could be 10%, 20%, 30%, or 70%, 80%. Now, any of us could have 10-20% blockage, and people with more than 70 typically have symptoms, like when they walk, they get chest pain, or, when they're rest. That is the stable angina. But attacks are typically like earthquake. That means it's difficult to predict it. What happens in attack is the covering, the plaque, which we say. That plaque, the covering of it gets eroded. It gets ruptured. So now there is cholesterol block, block because of cholesterol. Super added, there is a clot. So block plus clot together makes it 100%. So suddenly the pain starts and there is sweating. That means whatever test we do prior sometimes does not predict the heart attack which could occur tonight or tomorrow after itself. He was obviously fine. He was doing all his exercise. Now there are factors which lead to that plaque rupture. They're like earthquake. Whenever we do certain tests, we are telling you earth is fine today. But can we predict tomorrow's earthquake? It's typically no. The things which produce plaque rupture or produce heart attack are, one is smoking, second is emotional or physical stress, even extreme exercise can produce plaque rupture. So as you rightly pointed out, exercise is very beneficial. It can help a lot, but too much exercise can also kill, because that means people above 30, 35, or definitely above 40 needs to train themselves. It's not about one day exercise. Make sure you do warm up, you do cool down properly, and then train your body. There's no hurry here. And don't overdo any exercise. That itself could be extremely dangerous, overdoing exercise. we all hear about marathon runners at end of marathon having heart attack, or you know, people do get apparently healthy when they complete marathon and then have a heart attack most of the time because they have not cooled down properly. So warm up, cool down, exercise, all three are important. Don't overdo anything, shy away from old habits, and if there is a symptom, do not neglect. Majority do have some symptom which they have neglected. If you see, you know, they would have thought it is gastric or something. So do not neglect that.
So doctor, I have one question here. See, you said warm up, you said then exercise, cool down.
Yes.
What is it? Is there any kind of duration? But what happens to the heart when you have a warm up and exercise and then cool down? How does this prevent from rupturing?
Yes. This is again a very important question. You know, heart is an organ which is constantly in action. It doesn't know when you are exercising, when you are not exercising. It's like an engine. If your car cannot start at fifth gear, right? It has to start at first gear and second gear. So you need to tell your heart, I am exercising, you know, by warming up, stretching your muscles, making sure the circulation is good, making sure, you know, body breathing becomes normal. You're not making it suffer, you know. I'm sure if you start the car at fifth gear, the petrol is not enough there for it to sustain it and it will choke. The same thing happens here. Again, when you're stopping, you can't stop at fifth gear, right? People understand car better than their heart. So, you know, you can't stop. You need to get it down. So typically, although there is a no clear cut time what is given, what I advise all my patients is 5 minutes of warm up, 5 minutes of exercise. And if you're doing 15 minutes, 5 minutes of exercise, 5 minutes. If you're doing 20 minutes, again, 10 minutes of exercise. And remember, both warm up and cool down are important. You know, don't harm yourself. Make sure you follow a pattern and do it. And extreme exercise is not beneficial to anybody. The cardiovascular benefit of exercise is 30 to 40 minutes a day for 4 days a week. It's not very high exercise. You like more, you want to do more, you do it. But for heart benefit, this is the exercise we are talking about.
I think most of them here agree that they would go for a walk or they would step for a walk. So if at all it's a walk, say about 45 minutes or 15 minutes, do they still have to do a warm up and a cool down, or walking is still better?
Yeah, I think a slow walk to start with, increasing pace later, cooling down. You know, say if you're taking 4 rounds, the first round has to be slow. Make sure breathing matches what you do. Then you can go a little faster. It's good to do that, you know, go a little faster. Some sort of variation also is better rather than one pace. And then again, last one round, it's not that you're extremely tired and you're just sitting. Make sure you walk half a kilometer and then sit. Little slow walk, you know, that's very important. People are so, most of the time, you know, so competitive, so intense that as soon as the exercise is over, they just want to stand. They're so tired. Just stand. Don't do that. Walk for a little more when you do it.
Okay, doctor. So I think heart is something very complex, because if you just take diabetes or if you take some liver problem, all of them have that myth, oh, it's okay, I'm not 45, I'm not 50 to really get it. But the youngsters are being prone to heart attack is very devastating. So what do you have to talk about the youngsters these days? Why are they prone to heart attack?
So there are multiple reasons, Bhavana. One of them being, see, Indian itself as a, it's not a race problem, but what is noted is Southeast Asian Indians in particular have heart attack 2 decades earlier than Western population. In West, the mean age of heart attack is 50-55. In India, it is 35 to 45. You know, we do see younger people. It's multifactorial. The main reason is being actually risk factor. It is the same risk factor, but occurs earlier in India. For example, many young Indians are diabetic. Many young Indians are hypertensive. And there is increased prevalence of smoking in younger age group. There's also a lot of stress now, and working from home has only increased the stress. It has not decreased. And complete lack of exercise. You know, the Western, if you see the Western routine, they always have something. Physically, they're always active in something, either a sport or a game, or you know, there is something. Whereas in India, it is like complete absent. You know, when people say they might make a New Year resolution, but by Feb, everything is over. Until next New Year, there is zero. again, going back to that same question, if you rate exercise between 0 to 10, you know, 10 being maybe running marathon, 0 being nothing, 0 to 1 has maximum benefit. That means doing some exercise versus doing nothing has maximum benefit. That means everybody has to do some exercise, which is 30 to 35 minutes of whatever you like for 4 days a week. So in India, we see all this. There's also higher prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea now with more people snoring. Quality of sleep actually diminishing. And, you know, the younger people who are, you know, not even thinking about their health, you know, at 30, 35, people think they're invincible and they don't even, you know what they have or what they don't have.
So, doctor, let us talk about this comorbid condition here, like person with diabetes, person who are obese or probably uncontrolled hypertension are all prone to heart disease or a heart attack. Why is that? Why is this interrelated?
Okay. So these are the risk factors. These are traditional risk factors for heart disease. Heart disease has 8 to 9 risk factors and whatever you told are so-called traditional risk factors. So, again, discussing about this, we talk about cholesterol and we think cholesterol is bad. But it's not the cholesterol which gets deposited. It is the modified cholesterol which gets deposited. That means what modifies this cholesterol? These agents. It's not as simple as cholesterol getting stuck into the artery. It's something which is an active process which happens. So cholesterol gets oxidized. And the reason for that is diabetes, where the cholesterol becomes more and more triglycerides, hypertension, which leads to stress onto the vessel wall, smoking, which destroys the covering of the arteries itself, and obviously age, which you can't do much about. So all this together actually starts make the cholesterol deposited. So typically by 20 to 30 years, little bit deposit is seen in majority of individuals. After that, it grows. This growth is like cancer, you know, it has a mind of its own. There is inflammation coming in and it's coming. It's not just what you eat, it's also all these factors which join together. Again, getting back to that young people, it's unfortunate that more Indians have multiple risk factors. You know, that same diabetic patient is hypertensive, he's also obese, he's also not exercising, he's also not eating right, he has stress, he may be smoking, you know, versus one risk factor and multiple risk factors joined together becomes very complex. So just to add on, you know, just the last week, we had 3 people between 30 to 34 with heart attack. So young heart attacks are very, very common and we keep seeing it all the time.
Blockage of artery, right? So which artery are we mentioning? Is it the whole body artery or is it specific to heart artery? What is this artery?
Yes. So what we are talking right now is the heart artery. You know, heart is an organ. It has 4 chambers and it's full of blood inside. But unfortunately, heart cannot take its blood at all. It needs a separate set of arteries, which we call as coronary arteries. They originate from the main artery, which is aorta, very close to its origin. So left side, there are 2 arteries. Right side, there is 1 artery. These arteries are not elastic. They are like your radial artery. They are medium-sized artery. They're prone to blockages, you know. So when the cholesterol, which we discussed, gets modified and gets stuck, it's one of the arteries which is actually prone, and it's one of the arteries which doesn't take rest at all, you know, because there is a constant work it has to do. Heart is working constantly. There's more pressure on this artery. It's also contracting and relaxing. That means arteries also get kinked whenever it contracts, and it, you know, you can imagine it, right? So these arteries are unfortunately at lot of stress, and so the request is you all don't add to its stress.
So then, having said this, I'm not very sure in the participants how many female audience are here, but why is that women are so prone to heart attack compared to men?
Okay. You are so prone, huh?
I mean, that's what I've heard, that they are higher risk compared to men. Why is that? Is it the anatomy that contributes?
There are 2 ways to look at it. One, in reproductive age groups, women are protected actually. They have less heart attack. Being male is a risk factor. Being women is not a risk factor. It's beneficial. but reproductive age group. As long as estrogen and progesterone are there, it is beneficial. So typically in below 50, women getting heart attack is much lesser compared to men. But if there is a risk factor, if the woman is diabetic, hypertensive, smoke, takes oral contraceptives, you know, any of these risk factors, then all the benefit is lost. Then they become more, you know, they get more problem compared to the counterpart men. But otherwise, a healthy female actually is more protected than men, but it catches up. So typically in women, the heart attack, heart disease comes 1 decade later. But it's still the most important cause of death, even in women. In men, you know, it outnumbers corona or COVID deaths by a mile. Even in 2021, the most common cause of death world over, we have US statistics, but India, we may not have such good statistics world over, is heart attack and heart disease. Second is cancer. The corona comes, you know, COVID comes much later. And the risk of heart attack goes higher, but we are more worried about premature heart disease, you know. That is the young people getting heart disease. Yes.
So we have questions in the audience who've been asking about yoga, pranayama. If we do that, do you think, you know, that really helps in terms of, you know, probably it helps in maintaining or probably when the heart disease, what is that you have to talk about it, Doctor?
I think it's a good idea to do that. So the way we could put it, you know, don't do them as an alternative to exercise, you know, because when you do yoga, it's sometimes not quantified. Yoga could be so mild that you're just sitting and doing a shavasana and doing nothing, versus you could be doing a very intense hatha yoga kind of, you know, thing. So it's difficult to quantify. So my advice to most people is do your exercise. As an add-on, do yoga. Yoga does help in stress relief. It does bring, you know, it's a different kind of exercise. In exercise, you're actually constricting your muscle. You're actually stretching. So it's very complementary to the exercise which you do. It's something which we advise most people, you know, meditation, yoga, and relaxation, spiritual. These are the things which we advise people for stress relief. Do them, but do exercise also as an add-on.
So, doctor, there's another question where people are asking if they have cardiac pain. So, do they have to wait for the ambulance or are they in a condition to drive?
Yeah, I wouldn't recommend they drive, but I would, you know, best is to, you know, if you have a person who can drive, use their help to drive. And if not, wait for ambulance because it's a dynamic condition. Nothing might happen, but the person could faint also in between. So I think make sure you have somebody who knows to drive. Two people you should always need. Somebody who knows to CPR and somebody who knows to drive. These two will help.
So doctor, so we just spoke about, you know, the heart attack, the cardiac arrest. Although, I mean, the cardiac arrest is almost not the topic now because heart attack is something that we all have been reading. So what is the treatment plan for heart attack? What is this door balloon time and when would they reach the hospital?
Correct. So door to balloon, see, heart attack is time sensitive. So typically we classify heart attack into major heart attack and minor heart attack. That's common terminology. But there's nothing major, minor. Heart attack is heart attack. It has to be respected. It has to be treated. So when the ECG is taken, if ECG shows ST elevation, ECG, you know, then doctor tells you it's a major heart attack. That's a very time-sensitive condition. That means quicker we open up the artery, where by open up, we don't mean a surgery. It's an angioplasty. The better is the benefit. So that means muscle. That is a common dictum which we use. Now, typically what we say is door to balloon. That means you reach hospital door, to the time we put angioplasty, we put stent, it has to be less than 90 minutes. That is the door to balloon time. But then it is the hospital door to the angioplasty room. If you delay at home, then the benefit is lost. Imagine you take 6 hours to reach hospital and then doctor does it within 1.5 hours. Still total time of damage is 7.5 hours. You reach in 30 minutes, doctor does in 1.5 hours. The total time of damage is only 2 hours. So door to balloon is for us and we do follow this very, very, whether it is day or night, we do not wait. The teams are always ready. The technician is already there. The anesthetist is there. You know, most hospitals do have it in Manipal. We are very particular about that. So whole system is actually set to treat you as soon as you come. But what is important is you shouldn't neglect. I would be happy if your door, home door, to the angioplasty is within 2 hours, rather than 6 hours wasted here and we rush at midnight to do the changes. May not help you so much. So remember, shift the hospital door to your door so that you reach in 20 minutes to the hospital.
So before I have last question and you move to the demonstration, so yes. I have one thing to ask. See, everybody talks about stent. Is there a various, a different form of stent, or whether it is male or female, do we use a common stent?
Okay. So I know people are, the stents are, the stent is a material which helps us to open up the artery and keep it open. Now, there are many types of stent. Earlier, there used to be absorbable stent, which would completely get absorbed. But unfortunately, it didn't stand trial or logic and got withdrawn. So it didn't stand. So the present stents have 3 components. They have material, they have metal, then they have covering, which is like a plastic-like material, and inside that, they have drug. So they have 3 components. But stent is not your enemy here, because only putting a stent is like putting a patchwork on your tire, in your tube. When there is puncture, somebody puts a patchwork on that. It's not replacing the tire. It's just treating that particular heart. It's typically inert. By 1 month, the drug is released and body's tissue grows inside, and it's typically inert. So it's not about fighting the stent. Drugs, medicines will continue whether we put stent or whether we don't put stent. Rarely, or sometime, what happens is we remove the clot. Whenever there is a block, we remove the block. Once we remove the block, we don't see. What we do is we don't put a stent, but stenting or no stenting does not matter. What matters is having the artery flowing when people come with heart attack, and stent is not your enemy here.
So, doctor, there's one private chat that has come. How many stents can be used in one person? And yes. Suppose a person has already undergone one stent and he's on medication. Is he still prone to block? Get a heart block is what they're asking me.
Yeah. I think it's a good question. So one person, if you look at the world literature, I think 69 stents were put in one person. So it's not about the number. It's about, it can be put. More than one can be put. But typically when the blocks are in all 3 arteries, the main arteries, and there are too many blocks, we send the patient to get the bypass surgery done, because we don't prefer putting too many stents. But there are times it is needed, especially if the main artery is fine, the branches have problem, it is needed to put more stent. Now the other question, yes, once after getting one heart attack or one blockage, if the person is on stent, there is still chance of that person getting stent again. It's typically like what we keep telling, it's like your, if I go to the same analogy of your tube puncture or tire puncture, if there is one puncture, what does it mean? That you are actually prone for more punctures. It may not be the fault of the person who has done the first puncture job. It is because the risk factor remains and there is more area to get puncture. So that is what happens most of the time. The first stent related problem is within 1 year. So after 1 year, if you're getting new block, it's not because of the first stent. That area is more protected. It is the other area. So you have to modify your lifestyle. You have to modify your risk factor. Very important. What we know now is if you keep your LDL cholesterol very low, by very low, I mean 55. See, normal LDL is around 80-100. But if you can keep your LDL cholesterol less than 55, or in diabetics less than 40, your chance of new blocks becomes very less. But people after some time get tired of their medicine, They even start coming and bugging us, how many tablets should I take? Is it must to take life? The answer is yes, to prevent a future block, which could come 5 years down the line or 10 years down the line. Sometimes it's such a slow process that it doesn't come next year and you don't realize. You're happy your doctor has reduced your medicine. but make sure that you modify your risk factor. Remember, one puncture itself is a risk factor for one more car tire puncture. The same thing is with the heart. If you have something, that becomes the risk factor for the next event. So make sure you take yourself more serious.
Thank you, doctor. So do, because I think audience are kind of very keen to know, yes, what is that defibrillator and how does it work?
I'll do that, Bhavna. So can you see the...
Yeah, so we can see that. We lost you, doctor.
Yeah. Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you, but we can't see you.
Can't see me. One second. So should I... Yeah, now can you see?
Yes, doctor.
So, yeah, now you can see me, right?
Yes, doctor, we can see you.
I just did the manicule here.
Yes, doctor.
This is the defibrillator which is on my left side. So I think the CPR training is done right now. Huh? They know how to do CPR, no?
They have, but we would be going there for a demonstration. Before that, they were keen to know about the defibrillator. So yeah, okay. CPR is something that we would kind of handhold and tell them. But okay. Fibrillator, yeah, you could just explain and just demonstrate how does that work.
Looks like. So the CPR also, I'll just briefly tell how to do it. I'm sure our team
sure will. Sure.
When the person is lying down, unconscious, first thing, call for help, make sure people come. Second, start CPR. So when you start CPR, there are two aspects of CPR, breathing as well as compression. Now we have gone away from breathing. So you don't have to worry about breathing at all. So we have realized more compression, the better it is. So find this area. Usually find the lower part, come here. Keep your arm straight, arm straight, this straight, and start compressing 2 inches down, 100 times a minute. So that's how you do compression. So as soon as you realize person is not breathing, is not moving, breathing is very important. You could look down, see whether the chest is getting expanded or no, and see whether the person is breathing or, breathing. If not breathing, do not waste time. You have just 1 minute or 2 minutes. Start CPR immediately. And we'll send you a lot more videos. So once you do that, after 2 minutes, you need to reassess the patient. And shock early is the next dictum. And I'm happy you all are thinking about buying a defibrillator. So this is how the defibrillator looks. I'm going to turn the camera slightly here. So this is how the defibrillator looks. So all you need is you need to switch it on, the defibrillator. And then these are what we call as automatic AED. They are automatic AEDs because we know that for a common man, understanding ECG is difficult and we don't want you to do that. So what it does is, so there are two paddles which are available here. Once it is on, you could take the two, make sure patient shirt is removed, which is typically done even during CPR. And then you can see here, it's connected here, this part. Once you connect, the machine picks up the ECG. So the machine picks up the ECG, it diagnoses. So if you see my screen now, it's actually telling ventricular tachycardia or VF. That means it's asking me shock. So what I'm supposed to do is put it to whatever charge needed. So typically there is a knob where you turn the number to 200. When you are in doubt, 200. We do much lesser. Keep it here. The first paddle is on the chest, lower part. The second paddle is on the apex. As far away from each other. Keep it here. There's a button here. This says charge. So you could charge there. You could charge here, this button. Once you charge, you call for clear. Nobody should be touching the patient. And these are the buttons here. Simultaneously press these buttons and release the charge. Now, I'm not supposed to chop the mannequin. It might just burn up. So, but this is how we do it. So keep it here as wide as possible. It's all self-explanatory. See, this chart tells me where to keep it in the lateral part. This tells me keep it on the chair, separation as much as needed, and give a shock. If it is a child,
give much lesser shock. If it's adult, give 150 or 200. 150 is ideal because it's a bi-phasic machine. If it is a child, it's actually around 2 to 3 joule per kg. So for a, say, a 20 kg child, it would be 60. You know, you don't give too much for a child. For adult, this is what you do. Most of the time, the machine guides you what to do. If it is automatic, I would recommend you buy an automatic one where as soon as you connect, the machine tells you what to do. Sometimes it takes shockable rhythm, shock. Sometimes it tells continuous CPR. That is the kind of machine you should buy rather than these machines because you could do harm. Person is unconscious, he has heart rate, and if you shock, you could do harm. So follow the machine instruction before you do a CPR.
One question, when do I know, when should I be stopping this, you know, using the fibrillator?
Yes, Bhavna.
Sorry, when do I know that I should be stopping fibrillator, or is there any command that says
you know, these machines are, they explain.
Okay.
So if you put it on the chest, it will give shock, it will give, it will tell shock. And then it will tell you continue CPR.
Okay.
Which talks.
Oh, okay. I think that was amazing, doctor. So, Kota, will you be giving access to the participants so that they have their question answered, or do I just read from the chat box?
Okay. Yeah, the chat is already there.
Yes. Doctor, there is one question. Does popping painkillers help or increase heart attack?
Painkillers don't help the heart attack, and you know, they can be harmful.
Okay.
Painkillers can be harmful, so because using a non-aspirin painkiller actually increases the risk in heart attack. So better not to use it.
Okay. So Kota, are we having any, are you giving access to?
Yes, yes, doctor. There are a few questions and answers. I will unmute the audience. They will ask questions.
Yeah.
So first question by Abhijit, 1 minute.
I think I read the chat box. I took those questions.
Okay.
Just unmute them in case if they want to ask.
Abhijit, can you speak? Abhijit?
I think Bhavana already asked the first question. So that's that part is done.
Yeah.
By the way, Bhavana, there are also questions in the link that I shared with you, the pre-submitted questions. Please take a look.
Yeah.
Have you sent it through chat box?
No, through WhatsApp. I had sent it to you.
Through WhatsApp. Okay, 1 minute. Okay.
Okay, sure.
So second question by Bala. I am unmuting the Bala, 1 minute. Yes, Bala, can you ask directly, doctor? Hello.
Yeah, Bala.
No, I had actually raised a few questions. I think Bhavana had taken it up.
Kota, I think I've answered those.
Okay, 1 minute.
Okay, doctor, I think I have the question here. How to recognize, I think probably we just did speak about the cardiac arrest and heart attack. So there's another one which says that differentiating a stroke versus a low sodium sugar collapse versus a seizure collapse. So what is the difference?
Yeah, this is a neurological symptom, Bhavana, but it's a very good question. So if the person is unconscious, I think that's where they are worried about heart attack versus stroke. The person is unconscious, the reason could be seizure, which is fits. It could be a syncope, which is a transient unconsciousness, or the worst still is the cardiac arrest. So the breathing is the key. Generally, if it is a medical person, we ask them to check pulse. But for people, it's not easy to pick up pulse. So look for signs of life or signs of breathing. If chest is, nobody can stop their breathing, right? So if the chest is expanding, the person is breathing, and if the breathing is regular, that also means heart is beating well. And if there is any purposeful moaning, purposeful moving, or some painful movement like this, All these are good signs in the sense at least the heart is beating. A still patient not breathing is the worry. And low sodium also can lead to unresponsiveness, but they are typically breathing. But all these are medical emergencies. There's no question about neglecting them. The question is only whether you need to start CPR or no. If they're not breathing, start CPR. If they are breathing, take them to medical facility.
So can you suggest a blood thinner to be kept at home or should be used only in case of emergency?
Yeah, aspirin is a blood thinner to be kept at home. But then, I wouldn't recommend it. If the person is conscious, talking to you, fine, take them to hospital and then do. Or you could give aspirin and then take them to hospital. Only problem with aspirin is if it is a gastritis, it will only worsen with aspirin. So, to distinguish it, it's better to take to hospital.
What all an echocardiogram diagnose? Are there non-intrusive diagnostic method for detecting block, non-angiogram? Is it safe?
Yeah. That's a good question. What echo does is echo looks at the valve, it looks at the muscle, it looks at the, the pumping, but does not look at the blocks in the heart. To pick up blocks, major blocks, we need to do a stress test, which could be a treadmill or stress thallium. To answer that non-invasive method, the answer is CT angiogram. In today's era, CT angiogram can be done. It's non-invasive. Dye is used. Can pick up both minor as well as major block. If there are major blocks, we suggest them to undergo a conventional angiogram and angioplasty bar medication. If there is a minor block, we ask them to take lifelong medicine so that these blocks don't progress.
So when should we actually use aspirin? Is this a life-saving medicine?
Yes. Anywhere you suspect that it is a heart attack, aspirin could be used. But if you suspect stroke, don't use. But don't waste time. The whole point is time. It's all about time.
So are you recommending any kind of heart attack? People do use aspirin at a sublingual level, keeping under their tongue.
Yes. Yeah,
anybody who does not even have a symptom of heart pain earlier can still use aspirin?
No, they shouldn't. If you don't know, or if you just for sake of using aspirin, you shouldn't use, thinking that it will protect tomorrow's heart attack. It may. Well, medicine is sorbitrate, a nitrate. So people with heart disease, we ask them to use a sublingual nitrate. But again, it doesn't work if it is a heart attack. If it is a 100% block, nitrate does not relieve it, So be time sensitive. Remember, time is everything here. Don't try too many first aids. That's the message I want to give. Yeah.
So there would be a need to do too many things during a cardiac emergency with only a few members present at home. What should be the order of priority?
Yes. Order of priority is call ambulance, call for help. If it is one person, call for help. One more person should call ambulance, call your neighbors. And the third person in a cardiac arrest should start CPR. So if it is one person, don't just start CPR. Call people because it's needed. You can only give CPR for 2 minutes and that's not enough at all. You'll be fatigued and tired and you need to change over to the next person. So I think call for help is the first thing what is said. Because if you have help, they can activate the ambulance or the system.
Doctor, there's one sensitive question where they say that most of the cardiac arrest patients, when brought to the hospital, it is declared as dead. Why is that so? How can we prevent it?
Yeah, that is I think it's a very important question, Bhavna. That is the very thing which is worried. Because once person is unconscious because of a cardiac arrest, the chance of that we can save them only up to next 5 minutes. There's no way you can reach a hospital in 5 minutes. The CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, should start within a minute, latest by 3 minutes. But unfortunately, this is the time when people panic, They just don't know what's happening. Their near and dear one whom they were talking is now just on the ground. So it should be like a fire drill. They should practice these things, learn a CPR, but it's not learn and forget. Because if you learn and forget, you're not going to use it when you need it. So there should be a constant ways of like fire escape. Most buildings have a fire escape plan. There are always demo sessions which go on. So once you learn, you should be able to manage that scenario and understand and use it when you need it. So I think, Bhavna, the little bit onus is on us also. Once we train them, we should have repeated training or, you know, mock sessions to make sure people can do it. It's difficult even for doctors or trained professionals to act in the time of need, you know. Outside hospital setting, it's difficult for doctors also to act. So it's very important that we are ready with these things, and only that can save. If you have missed a heart attack arrest, then most likely it will be declared dead. Yeah.
So, annual heart medical checkup mandatory for all, or do you recommend any specific type of test like treadmill ECG?
Yeah. So what is important is to know the risk factor, as we've been discussing. People should know whether they're diabetic, people should know whether they're hypertensive, people should know that what is their cholesterol value. So beyond age of 21, everybody should know their cholesterol value. You keep checking your BP and keep checking your sugar. Now coming to the cardiac specific tests like treadmill, they're good to do, but a normal treadmill does not preclude from a heart attack or heart arrest. We need to understand. I've had patients who have come, done excellent treadmill, went back in auto, had a heart attack and came back in the same auto, a negative treadmill. So a negative treadmill does not, because I think the TMT exercise can induce heart attack, no? The TMT must have induced the heart attack in him. Rarely it can happen. So even though you have met the doctor the same day, the doctor says you're okay, you should still be vigilant. Your chances are less, but rarely it happens. If it happens, go back again in the night.
So is there any quick fix to know if my risk factor is high for a heart attack?
Yeah, typically it is basically traditional risk factor, which is hypertension, diabetic. Diabetes, having diabetes is like having one heart attack. So they are at a very high risk. Smokers, one cigarette is like you are at risk. There is no doubt about that. If you have a family history, young people having heart attack blockages, again, it is a big risk factors. And these are something. But predicting the time of heart attack is still very difficult. Exact time is difficult for anyone.
So what is the limit of the number of compressions to be done while doing a CPR?
A number of chest compressions.
Yeah.
100 per minute. So it's very tiring for the person to do that. So you need to compress 2 inches down, allow it to recoil, and then do it again. It's not easy without the training. It's like you're going to a gym that day and your stomach starts hurting. Next day, if you do a good CPR, don't break ribs. We will obviously train you how to do it in your centers. Go through it. You don't have to do mouth to mouth. And after 2 minutes, whether you feel tired or no, replace by the next person. The next person should be opposite. If you're on left side, they have to be on the right side so that there is no time gap. If you have AED in the center, connect it. It comes with patch. It comes with pad. Don't waste time again. If it says continue CPR, continue CPR. If it says shock, shock. First 5 minutes are very, very crucial. Make sure you don't waste time in first 5 minutes. Because if they have to come back, they will come back by that.
Doctor, there's been a question from one of the audience. I don't know who's asked him to advise to have a drink a day. But drinking 2 times is what I hope he means. Does drinking 2 times is harmful, as there has been advice to have a drink per day? I'm not sure what is this.
Yeah. Yeah. My talk is never complete without answering this question. So, 2-3, you know, people always ask about honey in water, hot water, and this question. So, I'm always surprised if it doesn't come up. So, the drink or alcohol, the general advice is to limit it less than 60 drinks per day, but you don't have a weekend quota. But unfortunately for us Indians, even a little alcohol is shown to be harmful in Indians. There is no doubt about that. The Western literature says little alcohol in them is beneficial, but very little taken regularly. But Indian literature, and there's huge literature there, which says even a little alcohol is harmful. So we do not advise anybody to take drinking. And we ask almost all of them to stop. And if they can't, limit it to very minimal. But general advice, stop.
Okay. So how do you reduce the inflammation in the body? I hear that prolonged inflammation is one of the main factors for heart disease.
Yes, excellent question. That is true. So to reduce inflammation, you need to exercise regularly. We didn't discuss much about diet today. It is low carb diet. Carbohydrate, sugar is the one which induces inflammation more than the fat. So it's low carb diet. Maybe, decrease the stress by taking regular break, meditating well, doing these kind of things actually helps.
One last question, doctor, considering the time limit what we have today. So can regular statins help prevent plaque buildup?
Yes, it does. It does. There is no doubt about it. But what is very important is who should get a statin. It's not everybody. So anybody with LDL, see, we don't look at total cholesterol. We look at only LDL. LDL more than 190 is high for everyone. They should be on good dose of statin. For diabetic, LDL more than 70 is abnormal. So they should be on good dose of statin. For people with heart disease, LDL 70 or even 55 is abnormal, as we discussed. They should be on statin. There are good there are one or two other medicines which have recently come to market, but till then, statin is the king. It's the single most drug which has shown big, big reduction of cholesterol and heart events. So if your doctor advises it, you need to take it, but for life. 3 months doesn't help. 3 months postpones heart attack by 3 months. That is of no good to anybody. Instead of getting March, if you get heart attack in October, I don't think so it will help anybody. If you have to take after your doctor's, it is for life.
So I think with this, we come to the end of our session. A big shout out to you, because despite being a Sunday, you get just one Sunday to relax. And, we really had to pull your time out for this engagement. And also another big shout to Abhijit, because he's been in contact with us. Although I know a few people who have been, writing. Pradeep is actually very close to us, who've been working closely with us. And thanks to the audience, and thanks to you, and thanks to Kota as well. Despite Sunday, also he helped us in, coordinating for this event. And thanks once again, doctor. And we would keep in touch with you when the fibrillator is being installed in the apartment. So they are kind of, discussing amongst themselves, should this be a need, for them to have it. So thank you so much, doctor. It was a wonderful session, very informative. And again, thanks to everyone who've been, joining this discussion. Thanks once again, doctor.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you,
Thank you, doctor. Thank you, doctor. Bye. Yeah.